Hello and welcome everyone. I'm David and in this talk I will be presenting joint work with Tibor Jager and Raphael Kurek about constructing efficient, adaptively secure IBEs and VRS from near collision resistant hash functions. When we construct identity-based encryption schemes and verify random functions, we want the constructions to be efficient and to have at least adaptive CPA security. Furthermore, we ideally want the construction to be in the standard model and to have a small or no significant tightness loss. In this paper, we show how we can use near collision resistance, a natural assumption for hash functions, instead of the random oracle model in order to achieve adaptive security. We do that by showing how to construct a more efficient IBE cam from LWE and from the bilinear Diffie-Hellman assumption. Furthermore, we also show how the technique can be used to construct an efficient verifiable random function from the q-decisional bilinear Diffie-Hellman inversion assumption. Finally, we also show how the technique can be used to prove the IB cam by my two co-authors from AsiaCrypt 2018 with very short ciphertext secure with significantly less security loss. However, we won't have the time to discuss all construction in detail. Therefore, I will focus on introducing near collision resistance as a natural assumption for hash functions to efficiently replace a random oracle, and on showcasing our techniques by using them to construct an IBE cam from the decisional bilinear Diffie-Hellman assumption. And yeah, our construction is mostly a variant of the Waters IBE, but with much shorter public keys. So for an overview over the presentation, I will first compare the efficiency of our constructions to previous constructions for an overview and to showcase what can be achieved with our techniques. Since we want to discuss our variant of the Waters IBE in more detail, I will quickly recap identity-based key encapsulation mechanisms and what they are, what their properties are, and in which scenario and how they are used. Afterwards, I will quickly introduce near collision resistance and how it can be used to achieve adaptive security. That is, I will introduce our hash function assumption of near collision resistance and then give an intuition on how we can leverage this assumption for hash functions to achieve adaptive security without random oracles. Finally, I will then present our efficient version of the Waters IBE and how a near collision resistance is used in our construction. Now let us begin by a more detailed overview over our constructions. First, let us look at IBEs from standard assumptions of the discrete logarithm type. That is, for example, the decisional bilinear Diffie-Hellman assumption, which underlies our construction, and also the Waters IBE. If we now compare these constructions, what sticks out is that except for the Bonnet-Fraclin IBE, which is in the random oracle model, only the Waters IBE and ours achieve user secret keys and ciphertexts of only two group elements each. However, Waters IBE has the large downside of having a master public key of linearly many group elements, which is, compared to many of the other constructions, very large. However, with our techniques, we are able to boil this down to only logarithmically many. And as we will look into the scheme later on, we will also see that this number is not only asymptotically small, but also concretely. Next, let us look at IBEs from Q-type assumptions, and in particular at the IBE cam from my two co-authors from AsiaCrypt 2018, which is based on the Bonnet-Boyen IBE from EuroCrypt 2004, which was only selectively secure. The construction at AsiaCrypt 2018 has one big downside, and that is its very large tightness loss. However, we are able to address this tightness loss with a more efficient reduction technique by Yamada from EuroCrypt 2017 in conjunction with near collision resistance. That allows us to make the reduction much more tight. And now let's look at the numbers. We see that the security loss of the Asia Crypt 2018 scheme is the runtime of the adversary to the 7 over its advantage to the 4. And we are able to reduce this to its runtime to cubed over its advantage squared, which is still large, but much better and much smaller. And if we now at the other parameters of these schemes, we see that only the ones from AsiaCrypt and ours, which are technically the same with a different security proof, achieve ciphertext of only one group element compared to the run of Bonet-Boyen from EuroCrypt 2004 and the run from Gentry at EuroCrypt. Next, we look into IB cams from LWE, which have post-quantum security, and in particular at the IB cam from Yamada from Crypto 2017, which we adapt to near collision resistance and by that are able to make a lot more efficient. So if we now look at numbers of at the parameters of previous IB cams or IBEs, we see that most of them are very efficient in terms of number of vectors for the user secret keys and ciphertexts, which is at least asymptotically all constant for most of the constructions. However, the parameter that is still very large is the size of the master public key. This is different for different constructions, but most constructions have parameter sizes of log squared security parameter or log cubed security parameter. And we are able to boil this down to only logarithmic number of matrices in the master public key. What is notable is that asymptotically speaking, also the scheme from Crypto 2016 achieves the same if we assume Q to be Q is the number of user secret key queries by the adversary to be polynomial. However, we point out that this number is in concrete terms much larger than the number of matrices in our scheme. Next, we also want to look into VRFs or verifiable random functions. And in particular, we want to look into our adaption of Yamada's VRF from Crypto 2017 with near collision resistance. Near collision resistance here allows us to prove adaptive security, but achieve very efficient parameters. Asymptotically speaking, we achieve public key and proof sizes of only logarithmic number of group elements, but this is not only asymptotically very efficient, but also concretely. We achieve public keys that contain only 10 group elements and proofs of correctness that only consist of 9 group elements for a security parameter of 128. So if we now look at an overview of all the schemes of most VRFs from before, we see that there are many of them, but we also see that most of them have log squared, log cubed security parameter, or similar number of group elements in the public keys, and in particular in the proofs of correctness, which is really important for communication efficiency, because the proofs of correctness will probably be sent much more often than the public keys. One construction that stands out here is run by Lisa Cole from PKC 2019, which achieves almost a constant number of group elements in the security in the proof of correctness. However, as I stated, our construction also achieves concretely very small numbers of group elements in the proof of correctness, however, being asymptotically less efficient than Cole's VRF. Summing up, Our constructions can improve over previous constructions in many different aspects, while at the same time avoiding the random oracle model and only making, as we will see, very natural assumptions for hash functions. Since we want to look into our variant of Waters IBE in more detail, I will now quickly recall the security properties and syntax of IBCAMS, and that is what our construction syntactically will be. For identity-based key encapsulation mechanisms, we usually consider a scenario with three parties: a trusted authority, and Alice and Bob, where Alice and Bob want to exchange messages confidentially. In the beginning, the trusted authority generates a master secret key and a master public key, and then publishes the master public key, while keeping the master secret key to itself. Now that all have the master public key, they need user secret keys in order to decrypt messages later on. So they can ask the trusted authority to get a user secret key. In this case, we will show this for Bob. And after Bob authenticated himself to the trusted authority, in some mean, the trusted authority generates a user secret key for Bob and then sends the user secret key to Bob. Now that Bob can decrypt messages to him, or better said, decapsulate messages to him, Alice can encapsulate a secret key to Bob. That is, she runs an encapsulation algorithm, which results in a ciphertext and a symmetric secret key, and then sends ciphertext to Bob. Bob, now using his user secret key, can decapsulate the ciphertext to the same symmetric key. Now, both Alice and Bob can use standard symmetric encryption primitives, like AEADs, for example, to exchange messages confidentially without any public key encryption, and so from this point on. It's common for key encapsulation mechanisms in IBCAM can be used to generically construct a fully fledged IBE when it is used in conjunction with the data encapsulation mechanism, or short DEM. This data encapsulation mechanism could, for example, be instantiated with some symmetric encryption scheme. In terms of properties, we want correctness, that is, if Alice encapsulates a secret key to Bob, and Bob always then Bob always gets back the same secret key by decapsulating. Of course, only if he has a correct secret key from the trusted authority, and both share the master public key. So for security, we consider the following security experiment between a challenger and a distinguisher. First, the challenger generates a master public key and a master secret key and sends the master public key to the distinguisher. The distinguisher then may make several user secret key queries, so it can query the challenger for user secret keys for identities of his choice and gets these. At some point, the distinguisher has to state a challenge identity, ID star, for which he gets back the encapsulation under that identity, so the ciphertext, and either the correct symmetric key that is encapsulated in that ciphertext or a random element from the key space. Then the distinguisher may make further queries, but not for the challenge identity, and again gets back user secret keys for the identities that he's queried. Finally, at some point, he has to state its guess whether he was given the correct symmetric key or if he got a random key that does not match the ciphertext that he was given for the challenge. As usual with such security experiments, we say that the IBCAM is secure if every distinguisher that has a polynomial runtime only has a success probability of 1/2 plus something negligible in guessing the correct bit B. Now that we recalled the properties of entity-based key encapsulation mechanisms and how they are used, we will now look into adaptive security from near collision resistance. That is, we will informally introduce near collision resistance as a natural assumption for hash functions, and then show how it can be used to achieve adaptive security without using the random oracle model. Informally, when we assume that a hash function is near collision resistant, we assume that the birthday attack is the fastest algorithm in finding a collision on any given subset of output bits of the hash function. To illustrate this, let us look at the following example. As a trivial case, for a collision on the whole hash function, we just assume that the success probability of the birthday attack is optimal for every potential runtime of an adversary. That is, for example, for this hash function with 16 output bits, we roughly assume that every algorithm that runs in time t has a probability of finding a collision of at most t squared over 2 to the 16. However, for near collision resistance, we now want to look at a subset of the output bits. So for example, if we now consider a prefix of length 6, then for near collision resistance, we assume that there is also no faster algorithm than the birthday attack to find the collision on the prefix, meaning we assume that the prefix is as secure as a shorter collision resistant hash function, meaning specifically for any algorithm that has a runtime of t, we assume that on this prefix, that algorithm can only find a collision with a probability of t squared over 2 to the 6. However, for near collision resistance, we also want this to hold for permutations. That is, it doesn't matter where we put these 6 positions, the probability of finding a collision keeps bounded by t squared over 2 to the 6. Next, let us look into how we can leverage near collision resistance to prove adaptive security without the random oracle model. Our approach is to use the runtime TA and the advantage epsilon A of the adversary in the reduction to choose a subset of output bits. We want to choose I such that, based on the adversary's advantage, it can find a collision on I with probability larger than epsilon half, and that at the same time, there are only polynomially many possibilities for the hash function value on the subset I. These two goals seem difficult to achieve at the same time, because obviously any sufficiently small set I will allow for a collision with a non-negligible probability. However, this is no issue because in the reduction we can assume that epsilon is non-negligibly large. Therefore, the bound of epsilon over 2 for a collision on the subset I is still achievable even if there are only polynomially many possibilities for hash function outputs on the subset I. Then the idea is to guess the hash of the challenge identity on the subset of output bits in I. The trick then is that if both goals are achieved, then this guess will be correct with a non-negligible probability, and at the same time, the adversary will not query a user secret key for an identity that also matches the guess, because that would imply a collision. Of course, these two goals are still conflicting with each other, because we have to make I large enough to make a collision sufficiently unlikely and at the same time small enough. Thus, there is an ideal choice such that it is just large enough to guarantee a sufficient collision resistance, but not any larger. Choosing it of exactly the size will allow us to make the probability to guess correctly as large as possible, and by that achieve a better tightness of the reduction. Concretely, what previous similar constructions did was to choose I as a prefix of length of the smallest power of 2 that is larger than the ideal size. In this example, if the ideal size of I would be 5, they would use a prefix of length 8. Then they would use several IBE schemes in parallel, one for each potential prefix length, with an identity space of all possible prefixes of that length. Since they only consider prefixes of lengths of power of 2, there are only logarithmically many schemes in parallel. Furthermore, they can use, in some cases, aggregation techniques in order to make the constructions more efficient. In the reduction, they will then just reduce the security of the IBE with the fitting identity space. This makes the approach rather straightforward, but comes at the cost of a large security loss in the reduction, because a not ideal size set I is used, and is this and as in this case, the set that is used in the worst case has a size that is quadratically larger than what would be ideal. Our trick now is to first present the ideal size of the set as a sum of powers of 2. For example, for 5, we can just represent that as 2 to the 0 plus 2 to the 2, meaning 1 plus 4. Then we split the hash function into consecutive blocks of powers of 2, meaning the first block h0 would be just the first bit, the second block h1 would be the second bit, and the third bit, and so on and so forth. So this looks like this. We would then choose a set I as a block that together has the ideal size. For simplicity, we will keep this notion of hi, h2, h0, and so on throughout the presentation and view them as hash functions on their own. However, this is only on a syntactical level, of course, this is still one hash function. The downside of this approach is that it requires us to make the reduction more complicated, because there is not a single, if we would just use several IBE schemes in parallel, there wouldn't be a single IBE scheme that we could reduce the security to. We would, for this example, with one, with the block 0 and 2, we would have to reduce the security of the first IBE scheme and the third IBE scheme. And this doesn't work out that well anymore. However, we can indeed do this without sacrificing any efficiency, and that is what we'll look into next when discussing our variant of Reuters IBE that uses exactly this approach of near collision resistance and this partitioning of the hash function into logarithmic many blocks. As usual for the Reuters IBE, we have two generators, G and H, and we have ZP elements X, U prime, and we have V1 UI element for each block of the hash function, meaning we say that the hash function has L plus 1 many blocks. As you can see, there are only logarithmically many of these UI values. And then we have that our master secret key is just H to the X, and the master public key consists of G and then G to the U prime and G to the UI for all I from 0 up to L, and the pairing between H, X and G, meaning that we in some way also put H to the X in the master public key and that by that bounded to the master secret key. What is now important for our construction is this function UI. U of ID. This function is just the sum of U prime plus the product between all UI and HI, meaning we interpret HI of an identity as an ZP element and multiply it with UI. This function is so important because it's very crucial for our reduction, in which we use it in the following way. In the reduction, we will be doing the following. We will draw a uniformly random element A from ZP and further uniformly random elements also from ZP, namely R prime and R0 up to RL, where, as you might have guessed, the R prime corresponds to U prime and the RI values correspond to the UI values. Furthermore, for all the blocks for which are of the, in the index set I, we also draw a uniformly random a guess for them named ki. Now we define u such that it contains this a component if and only if I is in the index set I. Otherwise, it is just ri. Furthermore, we set u prime as r prime minus a times the sum over all ri times ki for all the I in the index set I. Now, what we ask ourselves is, Under which condition is, if we said UI and U prime this way, is the A component of U of ID 0? And for that, we look at the following function, or the following terms. We ask ourselves, when does her told that 0 times A is minus A times the sum of over all Ri times Ki for all indices in the index set plus A times the sum over all indices in the index set for Ri times Hi of ID. And if we now slightly move things around, we see that this holds if and only if the sum of over all indices in the index set over Ri times Ki minus H of ID, if Z is 0. In particular, this is the case if we have that all Ki are identical to Hi of our identity for all I in the index set. Of course, there's also another way, other ways in which this could be 0, but in those cases, we can reduce to the discrete logarithm, meaning any adversary that finds another index ID, another identity ID for which this holds, can also solve the discrete logarithm problem, and therefore this is very unlikely. So overall, this A component is 0 if and only if our guess is indeed correct. And then in the reduction, we can embed this such that we can extract a solution to the underlying decisional bilinear Diffie-Hellman assumption if and only if we have that this A component is 0, and that we can answer the adversary's queries if and only if this A component is not 0. Now let us look into the concrete key size of the master public key of our variant of the Reuters IBE, since this is the aspect in which our construction or our proof improves over the previous construction. We require a hash function with 2 times lambda, where lambda is security parameter, plus 3 output bits. That means we will have the logarithm of that plus one many blocks. And for the security parameter 128, that means that we will overall have only 9 blocks in the hash function. If we now instantiate that on Barrett-Neerich curves, that means that the master public key will consist of 11 group elements from the G1 group and from one group element of the target group. On these curves, the G1 elements will have 256 bits, and the target group elements will have 3072 bits. Now summing up that overall, we achieve only 736 bytes in the complete master public key, which is quite small, and that without using the random oracle methodology. The takeaway message of our work is that near collision resistance as a mild hash function assumption can be used to replace the random oracle methodology without sacrificing a lot of efficiency. We've shown that it can be used to construct highly efficient IBEs and VRFs, and maybe there are more potential constructions, maybe some by you. If you have any questions, feel free to drop us an email and or refer to the paper. And last but not least, thank you for your attention and have a nice day.